92.7 The Block, ladies and gentlemen. We have a special guest in the building. Go ahead and let him know who I have in here.
Brother Nuri Muhammad, Nation of Islam and the Safar Khan's representative.
Brother Nuri, welcome to Charlotte yet again.
Thank you, Brother Chuy. It's an honor to be here and to be on a show with such a great, great warrior. Doing what you're born to do, brother. Keep on pushing and keep lifting people the way you do.
Thank you, sir. Brother, let's talk about what's bringing you to Charlotte.
Well, we, of course, you know, just a few months ago, we had the 20th anniversary of the Million Man March, 10-10-15, justice or else. And to be honest with you, we have a bad history as a people of going to gatherings, marches, meetings, and then saying, man, that march was something, and then go home and do nothing.
Yeah.
So 10-10 was important, but 10-11 and beyond, It's critical.
It's just as important, yeah. If not more important.
So because of that, you know, we have a checklist of action items that the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, through his deep study of the program of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, prayer, meditation, and the listening to the wise counsel of great black minds all over the world, he came up with some action items that they all put together, and we've been pushing them. And one of those is the development of 10,000 fearless men and women in the inner cities of America that can become peacemakers in our communities.
Now, what have you found as the biggest struggle following the Million Man March?
Well, of course, you know, whenever you have anything that has that kind of impact, then those who don't like atonement, reconciliation, responsibility, those who don't like to see black men returning home to be better fathers, those who don't like to see mentorship programs, they immediately went to work in 1995 to start undercutting all of the progress and the program that came from the Million Man March. So, you know, this time we are trying to build what you would call a built-in security system of having, right now we've got 138 local organizing committees that are in locations all over America that are constantly thinking, planning, and bringing into existence what we agreed to. So that's what happened. They went to work to destroy the good things that we produced. But by the grace of God, we still had some big wins. And this time, it's going to be even some bigger ones.
Well, I come from the belief where as long as you put in the work, you always got to get the outcome you want.
That's right.
Long as you work as hard as you can, everything always works itself out.
Come on.
In the long run.
That's
you know,
right.
I actually want to talk about how you got involved. I read a report where it said you started at the age of 17.
Yes, sir.
Take me back to then.
Well, you know, to put a footnote to what you just said, you know, one of the things that I would like to say to those who are striving to do something to make an impact on the people is remember this, that it's not the amount or the size of the group that's in the fight. It's the size of the fight that's in the group. So as long as you got your mind made up and you're willing to push forward with a small group of committed people, you're going to be successful. There's a verse in the Quran that says there's no good deed, even if it be buried in a rock, and that rock be buried in the center of the earth that goes without its just reward. So just like you said earlier, even as a man soweth, so shall he reap. What you put in, you're going to get out. Eventually, it may not happen when you want it to and the way you want it to, but the reward is coming. I came in the nation at 17 years of age. When I first heard the teachings of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, I had heard it from a sister that was my girlfriend at the time. We had been together in junior high. Her father, sympathizer with the nation, never joined, but loved How to Eat to Live, Message to the Black Man, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, Minister Farrakhan, and he had tapes and books. So whenever she was about 15 years old, they start introducing this books to her. Mm-hmm. So she start giving me books and tapes, and I wouldn't try and listen to it. But every time we got on the phone, all she wanted to talk about was black people, the struggle, freedom. And I'm like, man, I can't even carry no conversation. And kept asking, you know, did you read the Message to the Black Man yet? I was like, no. Please check it out. When I start reading it, Brother Chuy, my word is bond. I said, this is how I've been believing all my life. I just didn't know how to say it like this. And I started studying six, seven, eight, nine, 10 hours a day, and I joined the nation. And to be honest with you, the person that introduced me to the nation as a teenager, I came in the nation about August of 93. She came in September of 93, and we've been married now for 21 years.
Wow.
With three children. So
wow.
She not only my wife, my best friend, but she also became a savior of me to get me out, you know, of the streets. Before I joined, I was in the streets. You know, I grew up in a community called, you know, 40th Street. We called it the Fourth Ward. It was like New Jack City, mm-hmm, without apartment complexes, just the streets. Everybody sold dope. So I was selling weed when I was 11 or 12. I was selling powder cocaine when I was 15 and 16 years of age. Wow. 16 years of age, me and my two partners, we sold a half ounce a day and an ounce on the weekends at that young of age.
Wow.
But I was sitting on the porch one day, to be honest, and a thought came to my mind, Brother Chu. I said, man, I wonder what the dope fiend was doing when he was my age. And I took a tour of the hood. Didn't sell no dope, just toured
just
the hood.
Back then,
I left my pagers at home. You don't know nothing about that, Brother Chu.
No. You know, we're up on the iPhone right now. You know, when I was 15, cell phones were, I think, just now coming out.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
And so before that was the pagers.
See, we had pagers, codes, you know. You know, 411, 811, 911, 321. Yeah, now I know what that means. Meet me over there in the alley and then, you know, you want a half. I know what that meant. But I left the pages and went toward the hood, sat down with the brothers in the alley, went to the liquor store, and I asked them, I said, let me ask y'all something, brothers. What was y'all doing when y'all was my age? And they was like, oh, young blood, we was getting it just like you. And it dawned on me. I said, well, wait a minute. If
I'm doing what you're doing,
I'm doing what you were doing when you were my age,
where's that gonna put me when
come
I'm
on
your
now.
Age?
I'm en route to being you when I'm your age. Yeah. So, you know, in the words of Bishop Bullwinkle, I said, hell no. No, sir, I didn't want to do that.
Don't
so
worry.
I started going to church. And in church, I didn't feel like, you know, selling dope and using dope is the same.
Definitely, because you doing just as much damage.
You just as much.
You're using it as you sell it.
That's right. And you're an addict. One's addicted to the dope itself. The other's addicted to the money and fame that come with the selling of the dope. So it's just as hard to stop selling as it is to stop using.
Definitely.
So when I went to church, I was trying to get some internal strength to fight the urge to hustle. And I went to everything, Bible studies, all the double service on Sunday. And I didn't feel like I had the internal resistance and strength. And that's whenever my girlfriend at the time dropped the teachings of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad on me. And after a couple of chapters of Message of the Black Man, I felt so strong that I could conquer the world. My senior year in high school, I lived in the mosque.
Wow.
I went to school from the mosque. I had all D's and F's my first 3 years of high school, but after I learned the teachings, I had straight A's my last year of high school. So that's kind of the short story of how I got involved
with it. Now, this is what I want to ask, and I don't
yes,
want no offense taken from it, and I don't mean none by it.
Yes,
you know, a lot of people, when they see the Nation of Islam, they don't really know how to read it, especially with a younger generation that's unfamiliar with it.
Mm-hmm.
I just would like to ask that when you join the Nation of Islam, do you stop believing in God?
No. To be honest with you, the Nation of Islam is a criticism and a compliment of all religion at the same time. So in the nation, you don't lose your connection to Jesus. You just understand him on a higher level. The word we use to describe the supreme being is an Arabic term, Allah. You've heard different names of God.
Mm-hmm.
Yahweh, Jehovah. Yahweh, Jehovah means self-subsisting one. Elohim, masculine, feminine expression of God. Lord, Almighty, Creator, Father. All of these are different names of God. But what we say in Islam, we just say Allah. And if you look at the base word of Allah, A-L-L-A-H, it's all. So when you say Allah, you're saying Jehovah, you're saying Elohim, you're saying Amun, you're saying Amun Ra, you're saying Lord, you're saying Father, Supreme Being,
all
Creator, Infinite Intelligence. You're saying everything at the same time about God. So we, the difference between us, to be honest, is most people do religion to worship God. We do religion to try to become one. That's the big difference.
Wow. Very, very powerful. Thank you for teaching me, because I ran into a, when I was studying and doing my research, getting my information, I said, you know, I'm very uncertain, and thank you for clarifying it, especially for the people that's going to be watching this.
Yes,
you know, because if you're watching it, a lot of people, you have a strong following, they understand everything that's going on with you.
Right.
But then there's a generation that is blind to it, and right. I see a lot of times in the interviews where people are scared to ask it or scared to see what the response may be had on
right.
it. But I want to continue with your life journey. I want to continue talking about that. I saw that you ran into Minister Farrakhan.
Yes, sir.
How did that happen?
Well, the first time I met the minister, I was 19 years of age, and I had moved to Chicago, and we had a situation in the projects there, and he met me and said something about me then that he thought. And, you know, naturally, I don't believe so much, you know, in myself, but I was watching Biggest Loser. You ever watch the show Biggest Loser?
Yeah.
Well, the girl Jillian on there was dealing with a female client that kept on punking out and crying and
finding
getting weak.
Excuses.
Yeah, so she took her outside and said, let me ask you something. She said, what's wrong with you? She said, I don't believe in myself. And she said, well, let me ask you this, Jillian talking. Do you believe in me? Yes, I believe in you. Well, I believe in you. And if you believe in me and I believe in you, then by proxy, you must believe in yourself. So something the minister dropped on me when I was 19 years of age, even though I didn't believe in me, but I did believe in him.
He believed in you.
And since he believed in me, then by proxy, I had to believe in myself and start trying to do the things to catch up with that. So I committed my life to the ministry accidentally on purpose. They seen me studying all the time, and I was 17 years old. They put me on the rostrum. First time they asked me was a Wednesday night, and I told them, you know, to be honest, I'm not feeling too good. Only been in the nation 3 months.
Yeah.
And Brother Chewy, to tell the truth, I was feeling fine until they asked me to speak. Soon as they asked me to speak, I got sick immediately.
What?
So Sunday came, the main day. They said, well, let me ask you something, brother. The minister said, rumor has it that you were scared to speak on Wednesday. Now, you know you can't tell no black man he's scared.
Yeah, because then, hey.
Pride.
I got a.
And I was like, come on.
Dang,
I'm like, I wasn't scared. I wasn't feeling good. Well, how you feeling now? I'm fine. Okay, well, you on in 5 minutes. I was like, hold on, now time out. Can we do it?
Hold on, I got to prepare for it right quick. Hold on.
So they slapped me. They put me on the rostrum, 17 years of age. Never in my life did I think about being in the ministry. In fact, I used to tell the brothers, you'll never catch me wearing no dress shoes. I'm always going to have soldiering boots. I'm a soldier. I don't want to be in no leadership, and I don't need none of that. I just want to be here to get as many people as I can to come with me on what I believe is changing my life. Put me on the rostrum. I start speaking, and everybody was standing up clapping. I was like, what is going on? And I heard a voice in my mind, in my head, that said, this is what you're born to do. I got off the rostrum, ignored the voice, and said, you know what? I did it. I ain't never doing it again. Leave me alone. Next thing you know, next week came, I did a whole lecture, and history has been, you know, written since then. So I've been, I was put over a mosque at 20 years of age by the minister. That's how much, this is how special this man is, the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. Most people in an organization, they don't give leadership responsibilities till you get old, gray, and bald head. But I was 20, and he put me over a mosque.
And he saw the potential in how you handled yourself. Nine times out of ten, when you're 17 years old and you're getting up there talking in front of large groups of people and you're talking something that comes from the heart, something genuine,
yes, sir.
It sells itself.
Yes, sir. Well, thank you, brother. And, you know, praise be to Allah.
And I have nothing to say, but you're doing it. You know, you're continuing to raise the bar. Let's talk about the Million Man March and what it means to you.
Yes, sir. Well, of course, the movement is the biggest thing. You know, we can't allow 10-10-15, the Justice of Else, 20th anniversary of the Million Man March, to be a march or a moment, it has to be a movement if it's going to have some lasting effect. So I'm really trying my best to do all I can to second the motion of my teacher, the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. You know, like I know, if you're in a board meeting, somebody proposes a good idea and it's put on the table, it does not get activated until somebody seconds the motion. So the minister, over his 61 years of teaching us, has put a lot of motions on the table. But we that say we love, admire, believe in him, I don't think we've done a good enough job at seconding the motion. So I'm trying my best to be someone that seconds the motion. And I come to Charlotte, and then Brother Corey here, he's going to third the motion. You know, we go to Philadelphia, Brother Rodney's going to third the motion. And then we go to the people, and the people say in Charlotte, we going to fourth the motion. We going to fifth the motion. And the more people come in agreement with it, you know, it's kind of like if one person is saying something, and then you get two people to add and repeat the same thing.
Word of mouth.
The louder.
The word of mouth speaks for itself. Yeah,
And louder it gets. And the louder it gets, the more people are going to hear it, the more effective the sound will become.
And the harder it is to stop the movement. Let's talk about the name Justice or Else. Why Justice or Else and not something else?
Well, you know, of course, to be honest with you, Brother Chewy, when the minister put out the theme, he said justice, and he said, I felt a tap on the right side of my head, or else. And he put out the or else. And keeping it real, I was there when he said it in Atlanta, and I looked around, and some of the older people that were there, they start scooting back and looking around, getting real timid. You can see fear jump on them. But there was Clark students, Morehouse students, Spelman, Morris Brown students that he was supposed to be speaking at Morehouse, but he was denied. But all the students still came to the meeting at another location. And whenever you seen the young people hear the or else, they were scooting to the edge of their seat, shaking their head, rubbing their hands together, licking their lips, because to be honest, in this generation, we've been waiting on an opportunity to exact retribution on our enemy for the hell that we've been called. So whatever or else meant, we was with it. And of course, we galvanized, mobilized, and you seen Rick Ross came on board. You seen 2 Chainz come on board. Kanye came on board. Snoop came on board. Game came on board. The Goody Mob, Ludacris, artists from all over the country came on board and said, you know what? I'm with this. Justice or else. Justice or else. Because we didn't try justice or we going to strike. We tried justice or we going to pick it. We've tried justice or we going to vote. And ain't none of that work.
Now, when not to cut you off, I apologize. When you say justice, what in particular is the focus on?
Well, as you look in the culture of America right now, based upon the access to these video cameras on telephones, the stuff that police used to be able to hide and get away with, now they're being caught doing. So now you're seeing Tamir Rice recorded. You're seeing Mike Brown. We're seeing Sandra Bland's. We're seeing Freddie Gray's. We're looking at Walter Scott's. We're looking at brothers and sisters being murdered wholesale by the Ku Klux Klan. I mean, you know what I'm trying to say. The police department. And that's what Thurgood Marshall told us. He used to be a Supreme Court justice. You know what he said?
What's that?
After he got out, he went to Howard University. He said, I'm going to tell you something. The Ku Klux Klan do not wear white sheets and pillowcases anymore. They wear blue police uniforms and black judges' robes. Mm. They traded in the outfit, but they kept the same infit. So there are many people in the police department that operate with a Confederate mind, yet they are law enforcement. That's how you see in the death. So because we were sick and tired of being sick and tired of seeing so many young soldiers killed. Do you know that every 3 years, 2,000 to 3,000 black males are killed by police officers or correctional officers? That's bad.
That's a lot of numbers.
But guess what's worse?
What's
in the same 3-year cycle, 25,000 black males are killed by other black males. So when we stood in D.C., We sent a hashtag Black Lives Matter to the White House, but we couldn't send one to the White House and forget to send one to the Trap House.
Definitely.
We can't come up here talking about let's go to war with white supremacy.
And we causing harm in our own community.
And neglect the negativity that exists in our community. You know, I know that's not a real word in the dictionary, but you know what I'm trying to say.
I'm
it's a special type
I'm
of negative that only black folks know how to do to one another. So the war was on two fronts. So when we said justice or else, we're saying that if you don't treat us right and give us justice in the courts, then we will boycott you. We will withhold the spending of our money. So this Christmas, there was a massive boycott all over America. And right now, they're estimating that nearly $91 billion has been taken out of the Christmas economy. You're seeing Walmart shutting down 200 stores.
Wow.
You're seeing Macy's laying off 4,000 workers because of poor holiday sales. We're seeing 1,000 banks closing down in America. We hit them. And what we said to them, Brother Chewy, we said, look, no justice for us, no profits for you. If you won't stop, then we won't shop. Our theme was up with Jesus and down with Santa. So by promoting that theme, we were able to hit them where it hurts. So R or else for black to white, black to blue, black to the government was we're going to have economic withdrawal until we get justice. And we seen how powerful it was at the University of Missouri. You know, at University of Missouri, they had a racist president.
Yeah, and they got rid of him.
Come on now.
The football team sat out.
That's who did it, though. But you remember, for weeks, they had been outside with protest signs.
Then you had, so the football team got involved.
Come on now, brother. You even had the brother Jonathan Butler. The brother was on a hunger strike. They was going to let our brother die. They wasn't going to listen to nothing. But the minute that them 25 football players saying, you know what? Until he resigned, we not going to practice or play. And they pulled out that calculator. They said, wait a minute. $1 million this weekend. Shoot, in 5 weeks, $30 million in 36 hours. The president resigned, the chancellor, his cousin left the city, his mama. I'm being extreme.
Yeah.
But everybody quit. And what that says is that if 25 football players plus economic withdrawal equals the resignation of a racist president, then what would happen if 25 million black people practice economic withdrawal? Then maybe we can get white supremacy to resign once and for all. So we did it, and that was the or else for them. Now, after white boycott, we have a responsibility to produce a black boycott. Make sense?
Makes sense.
So we withhold money from them, but now let's start spending money with
on
each
ourselves.
Other. Did you know, Brother Chewy, that we blame the white man for 95% of our problems, but spend 97% of our money with them? Hmm. We black people are the leaders in unnecessary spending.
And now, what I want to make a point is, not all cops are bad cops.
That's right.
Not all white people are racist.
Mm-hmm.
You know, due to certain circumstances, a lot of things have now been put on the forefront. But right. I have to make that clear in this video.
I understand. And I understand. And I'll say this. The definition of racist is prejudice times power. So in order for you to be a racist, you cannot just have a prejudiced mind or an anti-black mind. You also have to have power to deny the person that you don't like access to freedom, justice, equality, life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. The white officers that are there that are not bad have a responsibility to put in check the ones that they know that are. And in the hood, last I checked, if I pull up at the gas station, you go, somebody else go in there that's in my car, rob it, and then jump in the car and I drive off, I'm considered to be an accessory to the crime, right?
Definitely.
And I get the punishment because I know something went wrong and I participated without stopping it. So what we're saying is that not all of the police officers are ill-willed or trying to kill our people. But man, if you are there and you know,
fix it,
then your job, your responsibility is to put the other ones in check. And I've never seen a report yet, Brother Choi, where black officers have went to a white neighborhood, stalked a white teenager, pulled them over, planted dope or an illegal weapon, beat or killed no white person just because they were white. But it is happening
in our community
to us. So that's saying that the mind of a racist has been monopolized as a general rule by white people that have the power. We've never operated like that, but they have. So somebody has to stop blue on black. But even bigger, we've got to stop black on black. You know one of the radio personalities, Don Imus?
Yeah.
You remember back in the day?
I remember back in the day he made, racial remarks.
Mm-hmm. He was on a radio now. Now, hopefully you can do that too, because he that man was getting two checks from one show. He was on the radio, but they filmed him on the radio. He got a check for being on TV and on the radio. I'm hoping you get you one of them like
that.
That's where
that'll come, man. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
make sure y'all check out my YouTube
interviews. Come on now. Come on. But he on the show when the Rutgers basketball team, a group of black women, was winning. This man said out of his mouth, he said, man, that's a group of nappy head hoes right there. That's what that man said on the air. Next thing you know.
My thing is, what would make someone even feel comfortable? Just the thought of that.
Yeah, but that's what I'm trying to say. So this is the racist anti-black mind that's coded in the DNA of this particular people. That's something that's deep that has to be studied. But my point was this. After he said it, all the civil rights groups came out the woodwork, attacked Don Imus. You better apologize. You better retract. Fire him. This man gets on television and says, well, I apologize, but I want to be clear. In my language, in English, when you look in the dictionary, the derogatory term for a female is not hoe, H-O-E. It's whore, W-H-O-R-E. I didn't say whore. I said hoe. And I learned that from the way you all talk about your own women.
Mm.
It got real quiet after he said that. What he's saying is that y'all come on now. How you gonna tell me I can't call you the N-word, but you call each other that? How you gonna tell me not to disrespect your women, but you disrespect your women? And now, flipping it up, if the Don Imus mentality can exist on a higher level, then those that are racist-minded police officers that are killing us, they can say, how y'all gonna tell us to stop killing y'all when y'all killing yourself better than we ever have killed y'all? So we got to stop. Not just white supremacy. We got to go to war with negativity. We can't just send a Black Lives Matter to the White House. We got to send one to the trap house. We've got to check our own behavior, because we cannot demand, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad said, another people to respect us until we first respect ourselves.
Brother Nori.
Yes, sir.
What you're doing now is very powerful.
Thank you.
What you're doing now is putting in the footwork of where a lot of people talk it. You're showing it right now.
Thank you, sir.
You're traveling. You're getting in the community where a lot of people are scared to get in the community. They talk a good game in front of a camera. They talk a good game on a microphone.
Yes, sir.
You're out here doing it. I commend you for everything you're doing, boss. I appreciate you stopping by here to enlighten me. And I appreciate you being open and honest about everything, because, like I said, there's a lot of people when it comes to the Nation of Islam, they're like, oh, I don't really know. They prejudge a lot of things don't know.
Yes, sir.
That don't know. They have no idea what the purpose for, what the meaning of everything is. And I feel as though you've cleared everything for it.
Oh, thank you, in this interview alone,
where you're continuing to raise the bar in the right manner. And you're doing it the way that it needs to be done.
Well, thank you, Brother Chuy. And I got a lot of strength from hearing the testimony of your story of how you came up and how you got to where you are right now. And I hope that those that are in your viewing and your listening audience will do what you did, find their purpose for living. Because at the end of the day, the minister said this. He said, the definition of happiness is one who has found their purpose for living and is fulfilling that purpose. Mm. They then have an unspeakable joy. See, real happiness don't come from filling full your pocket. Real happiness comes from fulfilling your purpose.
See, and my purpose would be my heart. You know what I mean? A lot of people that have known me, come across me, my happiness comes from within.
And what
it,
you
it
said,
doesn't come
man,
from money.
And you said something earlier about how you was doing what you was doing in the streets. See, once somebody finds out what they love to do and they are willing to do what they love for free, and then after they find what they love to do and are willing to do for free, they begin to do it so well that somebody wants to pay them for it, you know you got a man walking in his purpose. So that's you, Brother Choi. I got a lot of strength from you, and I hope that that you will continue to grow. I don't even hope. I know you're going to continue to grow because you have the right spirit, the right heart for the right time. And we need warriors like you that are willing to create platforms for our people to not just have entertainment, but we in need of some edutainment right now.
Exactly.
And entertainment and education mixed together.
And that's one thing, like when they asked me about the interview, Chewy, do you want to do it? Why not?
Yes, sir.
A lot of people are scared of, especially in my generation, a lot of my generation is scared of education. Mm-hmm. A lot of people are scared of having that flashlight shining in that dark area where, hey, man, that area is still there.
Yes, sir.
It's like if you in a room and you have to clean up the room. You don't clean up just 75% of your room and leave 25% in the corner.
Mm,
you gotta clean everything out. If you gotta do something the right way, you have to do it all the way. And you can't be scared of anything.
That's right. That's right. Well, thank you, Brother Choi. And I know that God is gonna continue to bless you and your family for you to be doing what you're doing, to look out for your mother and your family. You gotta tell your story on the air. Maybe I'll come back and interview you.
Maybe.
Because you need matter to fact, tell that story.
Matter of fact, we'll hold it to it.
Yes, sir. Thank brother you, my brother. Nora, love you, soldier.
Thank you for stopping by.
Appreciate
2.7 The Block. I appreciate you.
Thank
and
you, sir.
And my door is always open for you.
Thank you, my brother. Appreciate you, too.
Capture by Kev. Keep it locked.